It's freedom of thought. We got to fight the power. Stop being. Fight the power. Fight the power. Fight the power. What's up? What's up? Your boy back in the house again for another episode of what? Color Politics. Guys, it's a lot to unpack today. So without no further ado, we got to jump right into it. And you're asking yourself, Mike D, what we unpacking? Guys, we got to unpack. We got to unpack today this infrastructure bill. I'm quite sure you've seen the fighting back and forth. And I'm not talking about fighting between the Republicans and the Democrats. We got infighting in our own party. We got some Benedict Arnolds, some traitors, some Judas, some freaking double agents right there in our own party that won't let us get this ball across the line, would not let us get to the finish line. Guys, I'm going to unpack it today. And you're going to find out at the end, why do we have these culprits in our own party? There are a lot of things that have changed in the country, but so many things remain the same. I'm going to get right into this panel discussion so you can see and understand just how many things are in there that can be very transformational for our people. That's assuming we get everything done and get it passed. Roll the tape.
Pastor, first of all, thank you all for joining us tonight and all of you who are watching this virtually and all of you who will watch the recording of this. Black labor civil rights movement, there is no distinction, there is no separation. Understanding that for the Africans that were brought here, we were brought here for the exploitation of our labor. Once we were able to fight and gain our freedom, with the passage of the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendment, the three primary issues that was really driving our energies. One, our ability to negotiate for our labor. That's key. Two, our ability to fully engage and leverage our franchise to have a voice in the formation of public policy. That's two. And then thirdly, looking at the future, the ability to afford our children with a quality education. That has always been the foundation of a civil rights movement, with the franchise, access to education, critical thinking, and the ability to determine how our labor would be used. Collective bargaining is a part of that. You know, if you look at some of the foundings of some of our unions, particularly the Teamsters, those dock workers in New Orleans, those are African-American workers who had come together to form what ultimately became the Teamsters in the city of Detroit. Many people migrated north from, like my family, from Alabama or Tennessee areas because they were union jobs with the UAW. They did the same thing coming out of Georgia and other parts of Alabama to go to Pittsburgh for the steel workers and out of the Carolinas to New York, because those were jobs where our labor could be valued and we could earn a quality of life. So there's no separation. But as you look at this current package, I don't think the three things I mentioned before is any difference. One, the question of quality education. What we are finding ourselves in the midst of is a student loan debt crisis that must be resolved. You could provide people with really good work, but if they are in a cycle of debt, particularly student loan debt, that they cannot discharge in bankruptcy, and it follows African Americans far longer than others, we have to address that. That's not in the package. I want to be clear, but the administration.
Mr. Johnson, he just said something that Biden actually said he was going to address before he was elected. And in fact, he was questioned about that at a town hall meeting since he's been elected. He said he was going to do something about the student loan debt that is strapping many, many people in this country, particularly Black folk, because we have more student loan debt than others do. But one of his promises was that he was going to do something about that debt, that he was going to erase at least 10,000. Guys, he can do an executive order and erase it all. That's what I'm talking about, keeping pressure on the politicians. The fight is not over once they get elected. He hadn't done that yet, and that's a promise that he made. Roll the tape.
The ability to address that in two key ways. One, the number one workforce for African Americans is in government. There's a program that's already in place, Public Student Loan Forgiveness Program. The regs need to be revised so African Americans who are overly indexing in as public sector workers can get some relief. But the current program is not open enough to allow people to participate. Even with Build Back Better, you have to address that. With Build Back Better, to make sure that the jobs that come out are not jobs that large corporations or contractors are able to build the bridges, the roads, and still eliminate opportunity for African Americans. That's going to be extremely important, but that's only going to be, we can only be as effective at that because when the money finally is agreed upon and sit in the House, come together with the final decision, a lot of this money is going to be pushed down to local jurisdictions. And it's going to happen in the midst of an election cycle where our franchise is being threatened in ways in which none of us would have imagined just 10 short years ago, just 5 years ago. And if we are unable to influence the formation of public policy, when these federal dollars come in, if the right parameters are not in place, we will be left behind because some of these industries won't pay prevailing wage, they won't pay living wage, because they're going to be looking for a profit opportunity, not a people empowerment opportunity.
Stop the tape, please. He said something else important, and I always have to stop the tape and make it plain so everybody can understand. When the government money, when the federal dollars are sent down to the states from the infrastructure bill, your local politicians now control the money. Your state politicians control how the money is disseminated. It's very important that we stay on top of these things. When money is disseminated, let me give you an example. There was plenty of money that was sent to the states from the rescue package to address back rent payments so people wouldn't be homeless. How in the hell did that money get stuck at the state level, billions and billions of dollars that never got to the local level? We know how it happened, don't we? We're not stupid, right? Some call it red tape. I call it book. Roll the tape, please.
I appreciate that, President Johnson. Congressman Scott, how would you answer the same question?
I think you need to look at what we've done and what we're trying to do. If you look back at the rescue plan, you can see some of the success we've had already this year. Elections have consequences. Joe Biden was elected. And we were elected two Democratic senators from Georgia that gave us at least procedural control of the U.S. Senate and allowed us to pass the American Rescue Plan, which had many provisions, including the child tax credit, improved the earned income tax credit, $1,400 checks. When you add up all of what we did, child poverty went down 50%. Put that in perspective, the biggest drop in child poverty, and since they've been calculating it, the biggest drop in 1 year is 20%. We dropped 50% in 1 year. In the Black community, 34% drop in Black poverty in 1 year. We improved healthcare. We had massive investments in education and distributed the unprecedented amount of federal money by the Title I formula, which is primarily based on poverty. So the low-income areas got the most money. We saved about 1 million people's pensions. If you look back over the last 12 months, unprecedented money went to historically Black colleges and universities. And so I think if you look at what we've done so far, it shows that we're in the right focus. Going forward, we have essentially two bills, the Roads and Bridges Plan and the Build Back Better plan. And if we can pass those in essentially the shape they're in now, they will be transformative because it provides all kinds of things that not only will create the jobs, but will allow people to get the jobs. Massive amounts of money for job training, money for community colleges so that you can get your get training, jobs like training, like apprenticeship programs. Unions are very much involved.
Stop the tape, please. Did you hear that, guys? Some of the important things that are in the bill. You may have seen on the news recently about a big Ford plant that's going to be building electric vehicles. I think it's going to cost somewhere in the neighborhood almost $6 billion to build the plant, let alone, I think they said 5,600 jobs or somewhere thereabout, high paying jobs. But you need to be educated so that you can have that job. You need to educate yourself today for the opportunity of tomorrow. Well, some of the things that's in the infrastructure bill will address those types of things, meaning there's opportunities for people to go to school at the community college level to get the proper training that will be needed so that we won't be left behind when that place opens up. Oftentimes, we put our tax dollars behind something, but then we're not receiving the benefit of the tax dollars that we put forth. And then they'll tell us, well, we don't have a trained workforce. Well, damn, the door's going to open. Somebody's going to be in there working. We need to be in there working. Roll the tape.
Things like childcare, the massive investment in childcare and early childhood education. If you have young children and can't afford childcare, you can't go to work. So the massive investments in childcare and early childhood education, which will provide the daycare so people can go to work, but also will get young people off on the right track so that they will be much better educated and on the right track. We improve child nutrition services. And so I think if you look at what is in the bill, and we don't know if we can pass it. Everybody's been following the news. We may not have the votes, but if we pass this, it will be transformational in terms of people's ability to get work, and specifically in terms of civil rights enforcement, significant new investments in the EEOC and the Office of Federal Contracts Compliance Program, OFCCP, to make sure that the civil rights laws are being enforced. So there's a lot in this bill for everybody. If we can do the kind of things that we did in the last bill in terms of alleviating poverty, we'll go a long way in improving a lot of African Americans. And I'd just like to say one additional word. There are provisions in there to strengthen labor laws to help people join unions. If you can get into a union, you get more money, you get better working conditions, you get better benefits, including a pension, which is a huge asset. People talk about the wealth disparity. Well, in the union contract, there's no difference in pay between blacks and whites and men and women. You get equal pay for equal work, you get more money, and you're more likely to get a pension, which is a huge asset to come into to a family. So we've got a lot of potential, but like I said, we're not sure we can pass the bill. We need support, and if we can pass it, it will be transformational in terms of people's ability to go to work.
Stop. And we're going. He just mentioned something else that was in the bill that was very important, and like I say, I have to stop the tape and break it down. And break it down into the lowest common denominator for my people. There's money in the bill to strengthen unions, to strengthen pensions. Pensions are almost a thing of the past now. I have a best friend who was working for Kroger for 20 something years. When he signed on to work for him 24, 25 years ago, he was told that he was working towards a pension. All of a sudden, they do away with the pension and say they're taking that money and put it in a 401k. 401, great, but it's not a pension. I mean, they seem to always play games, but the game that they're playing seems to always hit us the hardest. But there's things in this bill that will address some of those things. Roll the tape, please.
On how it gets passed, because we realize it's not going to happen based on magic. And so I appreciate everything that you were just saying.
Like, let me tell you, he's not the only one. I mean, yeah. I'm talking about the House.
Yeah, I hear you. I hear you.
Okay.
One more on the same question, Vice President Brown, if you want to offer your insight in terms of that question, and then we're going to move to another one.
Thanks so much, Bill. I really appreciate it. I was going to jump in if you didn't ask, so thank you. On the human infrastructure bill that Congressman Scott just mentioned, that $3.5 trillion bill, to Dr. President Johnson's point, there are some really key educational pieces built into that bill. And so to Congressman Scott's point, we got to get it done. There's money for free community college tuition. There is increased funding for Pell Grants, not loans, but Pell Grants. And, you know, in addition to the childcare piece that Congressman Scott mentioned, there's also money for HBCUs. So it adds to the money that has already been spent during this pandemic to provide additional funding for HBCUs. So that's a really key bill. On the physical infrastructure side, the $1.2 trillion package, you know, there's a ton of new spending. We already talked about the $550 billion of new spending that's in there. But when you really drill down, there's tremendous opportunity to direct that spending to our communities. We talk so much about Flint, right? When we think about water, we talk about Flint, but there's so many communities around this country that really need targeted, directed investment. There's about $55 billion of money in that $1.2 trillion package to make upgrades to our water systems. We just have been through this whole period where kids have been home, you know, with their parents trying to figure out school. So many children in communities across this country could not access the internet. We're all on the internet right now. We're doing this Zoom call. So many kids across this country could not access internet. There's $65 billion in this bill, that $1.2 trillion bill for broadband.
Stop the tape.
There's about $14 billion.
There are things in the infrastructure bill, or there's monies in the infrastructure bill that will address something called the digital divide. When the pandemic occurred, all it did was highlight the fact that many of our people didn't have the proper internet or high-speed connections to perform their work or get online properly, let alone if you had two and three kids or four kids in the household with individual laptops or what have you, or pads, trying to access the internet, and you couldn't do it. So you're talking about a group of people who may have already been behind educationally. Then the pandemic makes you farther behind because of the things you're already lacking. So there's monies in the bill to address the digital divide. We got to get this bill passed, guys. Roll the tape.
That bill that would allow internet to be more affordable for our communities. So when we're talking about, you know, making these policies do what they need to do for our communities, the education piece is key, but also directing that new money, that $550 billion of new money, to communities that have been ignored for so long and who really, really need that direct investment. So there's tremendous opportunity. I keep hearing the word opportunity. There's so much opportunity, but we have to get it done. And I think, you know, in terms of how we make sure that this happens, we keep the pressure on. We have our friend, Congressman Scott, on this call. But we have to keep the pressure on to so many different lawmakers to try to get this done. our union is doing our part. We're really, you know, we've taken our message to the streets with our We Supply America campaign, but there's so much that we need to do to get both of these bills across the finish line.
Stop. Thank you. Please. Guys, she's right. She's right on target. We have to get both of these bills across the finish line. We are at a crossroads here, guys. You think that they would be fighting so hard against it if it wasn't going to be meaningful to our community? Elections have consequences. They do. We control the House, we control the Senate, and we have the president and the vice president. It's a slim margin, but we do control it. But unfortunately, like I said earlier, we got some Benedict Arnolds, some traitors, some double agents, and some Judas in the midst of the camp. Particularly Kyrsten Sinema and Joe Manchin. But we got to deal with this, guys. We still cannot allow them to stop this progress. We must get these bills across the finish line. We must get them across the finish line. You know, in this country, there has been some progress that has been made. I don't want to say it hasn't, but there's a lot of things that still remain the same. Martin Luther King said a few things back in the 60s that still hold true today. And it holds true in reference to why we are fighting so hard to get this infrastructure bill done. This infrastructure bill will not just help Black folk, but it'll help all types of folk, white folk, Asians, whomever, that are marginalized, poor, or working class. Why don't we just hear what Martin Luther King said is the real issue with white America? Roll the tape.
Do you think white people in this country, and I'm talking about non-segregationists, people devoid or thinking they're devoid of racism, do you have any idea of what they want the Negro to be in America?
Well, it depends on the level that we are talking here, because I think you have to make a distinction between the people who are genuinely and absolutely committed in the white community on the question of racial equality. And I must confess that I think they are in a very small minority. I think the vast majority of white Americans will go but so far. It's a kind of installment plan for equality, and they are always looking for an excuse to go but so far.
Why are they looking for the excuse? What is it about the Negro? I mean, every other group that came as an immigrant somehow, not easily, but somehow got around it. Is it just the fact that Negroes are Black?
That's a part of it, and growing, that grows out of something else. You can't thingify anything without depersonalizing that something. If you use something as a means to an end, at that moment you make it a thing and you depersonalize it. The fact is that the Negro was a slave in this country for 244 years. That act, that was a willful thing that was done. The Negro was brought here in chains, treated in very inhuman fashion. And this led to the thingification of the Negro. So he was not looked upon as a person. He was not looked upon as a human being with the same status and worth as other human beings. And the other thing is that human beings cannot continue to do wrong without eventually rationalizing that wrong. So slavery was justified morally, biologically, theoretically, scientifically, everything else. And it seems to me that white America must see that no other ethnic group has been a slave on American soil. That is one thing that other immigrant groups haven't had to face. The other thing is that the color became a stigma. American society made the Negro's color a stigma. And that can never be overlooked. So I think these things are absolutely necessary. The other thing is that America freed the slaves in 1863 through the Emancipation Proclamation of Abraham Lincoln, but gave the slaves no land or nothing in reality, and as a matter of fact, to get started on. At the same time, America was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that there was a willingness to give the white peasants from Europe an economic base. And yet it refused to give its black peasants from Africa, who came here involuntarily in chains and had worked free for 244 years, any kind of economic base. And so emancipation for the Negro was really freedom to hunger. It was freedom to the winds and rains of heaven. It was freedom without food to eat or land to cultivate, and therefore it was freedom and famine at the same time. And when white Americans tell the Negro to lift himself by his own bootstraps, they don't look over the legacy of slavery and segregation. I believe we ought to do all we can and seek to lift ourselves by our own bootstraps, but it's a cruel jest to say to a bootless man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. And many Negroes, by the thousands and millions, have been left bootless as a result of all of these years of oppression and as a result of a society that deliberately made his color a stigma and something worthless and degrading.
Stop the tape. That's a drop the mic moment. That was in the 60s, not long before he was assassinated. It's this right here, the color, that's the problem. See, that's why you got a Joe Manchin and a Christian Sinema that's fighting against it. Because they only gonna let that black man go, but so far, fam. But so far, before they need to put a stop to it. Because really, they don't want real, true equality. But guess what? It's a God in heaven. Sit on high and look low. We're gonna get there, fam. And we're gonna get there because we're gonna get the knowledge. And we're going to understand what to do with the knowledge. You on the winning team? I am. Stay tuned. Mike D will be back next time for another episode of Guess What? Color Politics. And you know what I always say? Knowledge is power. But what you do with that knowledge is what's going to make you powerful. Peace. Gotta give us what we need. Our freedom of speech is freedom of death. We got to fight the power of that beat. Fight the power. Power.